Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Espiritismo, Puerto Rican Mediumship, and Magic by Hector Salva. Narrated by Gary Tiedemann. Preface. The principles of faith, hope, and charity form the foundation of the guiding values that Espiritistas strive to channel. Their purpose is to live in faith of the divine, to act as a foundation of hope for others and for themselves, and to be generous, kind, and compassionate toward all. Faith in what we know to be true confers strength, and where strength exists, weakness cannot. True faith burns like a fire in the heart of those who know what they know and move forward in strength on that knowledge. Where faith exists, fear cannot enter. Hope is the driving force of life. It is what keeps us pushing, alive, growing, and wanting more. Without hope, humanity would have become extinct long ago. Many have been saved by the power of hope alone. Many have been lifted by her gentle hand from the deepest of ditches. Many have found their way out of the depths, illuminated by just a glimpse of her strength-giving light. Through charity, we help others progress on their spiritual paths and develop their connection to the divine. Through charity, we encourage both faith and hope. Through charity, we manifest love. Message from the enlightened spirits via Papa Hector. Introduction. Everywhere truth. You just have to find it. Doña Juana, Espiritista. You are about to start an incredible journey into the spiritual world, a journey of wisdom and empowerment, a journey into a deep part of yourself, a journey that will unlock and open doors into a world of beauty and mystery that consists of much more than just what the eye can see. In fact, Puerto Rican Espiritismo is a spiritual practice that is designed to open the many realms of existence to you. Its practices can help you grow on all levels and encourage you to experience life in ways that will strengthen and clarify your connection to the divine. Its wisdom nurtures you and gives you understanding of life, and beyond that, can help you find wholeness. Its principles form a complete philosophy of balance, wellness, and health. The teachings of Espiritismo are the same as those found in all teachings of truth. The same wisdom can be found in all traditions, religions, and sects. Espiritismo merely distills this wisdom into its purest form. That is why I often refer to it as the science of the spirit. My own spiritual journey down this path began at birth. I was born and raised in a family of Espiritistas. At one time, almost every member of my family was a practitioner of Espiritismo or some related form of spirituality. In fact, my entire family history weaves together a story of struggle, beauty, life, and magic. Espiritismo has always been and still is a part of my daily life. Its truths have guided me spiritually from the very beginning and continue to do so now. The wisdom that I gained from growing up in Espiritismo has helped me throughout my entire life journey and granted me understanding where others found only confusion. It has been the foundational vehicle through which I was able to reach total awakening and enlightenment. I grew up with my maternal grandmother, who was a well-known Espiritista and healer. She ran a full-time healing practice while raising a bunch of grandkids and adopted children and pursuing her own divine mission of feeding the people. A normal day in our home consisted of her cooking more than 10 pounds of food as she consulted with and healed people at our dining room table. As well as being practitioners of Espiritismo, we were also members of a Pentecostal church. If you know anything about Pentecostalism, then you know that this appears to be a huge contradiction. But there were reasons for this odd mix of faiths. In fact, this spiritual mix is not uncommon in Puerto Rican families, as you will discover. My grandfather had become a Pentecostal Christian quite some time before I was born, and this conversion totally changed his life. My grandmother supported him wholeheartedly in this, often saying it was the best thing that happened to him when he accepted Christ. His new faith changed my grandfather from an alcoholic womanizer, albeit a hard-working man, to a loyal, faithful, and sober person. It gave him a sense of stability and a moral compass. Amazingly, he never tried to push his newfound connection with the divine on my grandmother. As he put it, when I met her, she was already more of a saint than a human being, more of a nun than the nuns. My grandfather feared but respected the spirits and my grandmother's traditional practices. His own mother was an espiritista and healer, and he had grown up around the work, so he fully supported all my grandmother's desires and contributed to her mission of feeding people. He even bought healing items for people when they couldn't afford them and helped my grandmother maintain her healing garden and all the plants and herbs she used in her practices. Surprisingly, my grandmother was a highly active and well-respected member of my father's church as well. She became an elder, and her counsel was regularly sought in all important matters. In fact, no big decisions were ever taken without her input, even though it was well known by all that she was an espiritista. This church, she said, was better than the Catholics because you get to have the Holy Spirit. Pentecostals believe in possession and messages delivered via the Holy Spirit, and highly value the gift of speaking in tongues. As my grandmother often said, God is everywhere, at home and at the church. So it was common for us to attend reuniones espirituales, espiritista rituals on Friday or Saturday night, and attend church on Sunday, Tuesday, and Thursday. Yes, God and spirit were number one in my household growing up. When speaking about it, I often joke that it was a full-time job. This intense spirituality, however, instilled in me the capacity to see how important the divine really is in life. In fact, some people endure incredible amounts of suffering daily simply because they lack this personal connection to the divine. Illnesses, emotional and mental problems, and issues in relationships all have a spiritual component and reflect an imbalance that could so easily be corrected if the divine were present. In my grandmother's home, it was normal for people to start showing up for spiritual help anytime after 8 o'clock in the morning. In fact, they showed up at all hours of the day or night, especially in emergencies. Once there, they were usually invited to have some coffee or juice as they waited until my grandmother was ready to attend to them. Our dining room table was not just for eating. It was a center for healing, love, connection, and much more. She sat people down there and consulted with them. Sometimes she asked them to bring something back so she could help them. Sometimes she referred them to other spiritual workers who were specialists in the issues they needed to resolve. And sometimes she simply told them what they needed the moment she saw them. As all of this was going on, this remarkable lady had huge pots of rice and meats cooking. The smells of the delicious food permeated the whole house. If the food was done, people were invited to share it. My grandmother's mission was not just to nourish the spirit, but to feed the body as well. And we also regularly had people who needed help staying with us. Every evening, mats, quilts, and blankets were brought out to make up pallets for those in need. In our house, you frequently had to jump over people to get from one place to another at night. It was not uncommon for us to have more than a dozen people staying with us at any given point. In addition to my grandmother, several of my paternal great-aunts, uncles, and cousins were practicing espiritistas as well. Many of them practiced sanse espiritismo, a related type of spirituality. Two of them led centros, or spiritual centers, where they regularly held spiritual rituals. Some were involved in the 21 divisions, a Dominican spiritual tradition. Others were involved in Santeria, a Cuban spiritual path. As I said, spirituality and religiosity were a basic component of my family life. Puerto Rican Espiritismo. The history of Puerto Rico and its many people is like a quilt, with many different types of fabric that have been sewn together. Over time, many cultures left their imprint on Puerto Rico, including their spiritual imprint. The island became home to many refugees, as well as a place to which many came for commerce and a chance to better their lives. One result of this cultural merging is Espiritismo, a Spanish word that means Spiritism. Espiritismo is a spiritual path of development and mediumship that incorporates a belief in one God and in a spiritual world that contains many spirits, both incarnate and disincarnate, who affect each other and us. Espiritismo is often referred to as la obra, or the work. Not just any work, but the sacred work of God. Espiritistas function as a channel for God, for la luz, the light, and for the spirits of healing and good. The focus of this sacred work is the path of development. Most Puerto Rican Espiritistas are Catholic in background, although this is not a requirement, and there are Espiritistas from various other religious backgrounds as well. Some are Protestant, some are Muslim, and some are even scientists. In fact, during this period of growth, many different types of Espiritismo were formed. Most practitioners do not even consider Espiritismo to be a religion. They see it rather as a spiritual practice of development that can complement any religion. In fact, the truths of Espiritismo, properly understood, are the underlying truths of all religions. Its teachings are universal. Puerto Rican Espiritismo combines elements of Catholicism, Protestantism, various indigenous native spiritualities, shamanism, European Spiritism and Spiritualism, New Age spirituality, and more. It was birthed on the island of Puerto Rico, where, as you'll hear, many diverse influences came together to form the culture, the traditions, and the people. All these influences are reflected within Espiritismo. Puerto Rican Espiritismo teaches that the goal of life is to come closer to God by undergoing the process of desarrollo, or unravelment. It is grounded in the belief that the spiritual world and the physical world are interdependent and interactive. Thus, by practicing and participating in an active spiritual life, we can affect and improve our physical existence. Since many of our problems are caused by being apart from the divine, we can improve our lives by drawing closer to the divine. Espiritismo also teaches that faith, hope, charity, forgiveness, love, empathy, and gratitude are the ways to live a healthy life. It encourages the development of high ethical and moral values that act as a guide to its practitioners. Through its practices, we can enrich our lives and our souls. Espiritismo is grounded in beliefs and practices that are needed to live a successful life. As a healing tradition, it works in a holistic way to heal people on all levels. In fact, all levels of the human experience are addressed by Espiritismo. Puerto Rican Espiritismo is also known as Mesa Blanca, meaning white table, because its foundational ritual, known as a reunión espiritual, or spiritual reunion, is conducted on a table covered by a white cloth. During this ritual, practitioners known as Espiritistas communicate and interact with the spiritual world and with spirits to convey their messages to the living who are present. In this process, healing can occur, wisdom can be dispensed, and lessons can be learned. There is a wide range of skill among Espiritistas, as well as a wide range of depth to their practices. Some are more casually involved, others are very deeply committed. Some are mediums who can communicate and interact with the spirit world and thus act as vehicles for healing. Some mediums, known as brujos, can work with the spiritual world to create miracles and change for others. In Espiritismo, there is no grand hierarchical structure. Instead, its practitioners are recognized for the level of development of their spiritual abilities. The more developed an Espiritista, the more elder he or she is in relation to others. These elders are often called mayores or viejos, the old ones. The tradition of Espiritismo is transmitted via apprenticeship that includes study and training as well as personal and group rituals. Apprentices undergo healings, spiritual development, and other personal practices. Master teachers are known as padrinos, male, and madrinas, female, while students are called ahijados, or godchildren. Why I wrote this book. Right now, a powerful awakening is underway. People are becoming more and more conscious. Many old restrictions or ways of being that prevented people from opening up are falling away. Right now, the wisdom of Espiritismo is needed by people more than ever before. In our fast-moving and disconnected society, we need to maintain our connection to the divine more than ever to make our lives joyous. Espiritismo provides the foundational and universal wisdom that can give us that connection. Its truths are applicable to all. It doesn't require that anyone change their religion or their beliefs. Rather, it gives a clarifying, penetrating knowledge of what truth is. It can be practiced in harmony with any religion or with no religion at all. Espiritismo holds the hermetic truth that what you seek is within you. You are divine and connected to the divine in many ways. Its practices, teachings, and rituals can lead you to that truth. Its wisdom and insights can lead you to enlightenment. In fact, it is one of the few paths outside of Eastern spiritualities and religions devoted to that goal. Espiritismo holds fundamental spiritual truths and essential wisdom teachings that are slowly being lost. As people and cultures shift, morph, and change, they tend to lose sight of what is important, and this causes unnecessary suffering. By recognizing the truth and spirit in all paths, Espiritismo offers a way out of this dilemma. From darkness into light. Tia Nereida always awoke bright and early, taking her time for a morning ritual that consisted of eating breakfast slowly and methodically making herself up for the day while music played softly in the background. Nene, don't rush, she would say. In la vida, there is time for everything. Time is my best friend. He waits upon me. We miss so much when we constantly obsess over getting things done. Tia, how did you become a bruja? I asked. I was born one, of course, just like you, she replied, smiling. I mean, how did you know? I countered. Ever since I can remember, I could see things, she began. But I never told anyone, because my mother is a bruja, and I didn't want to be one. I thought if I didn't talk about the visions, they would just stop. Then, when I was a teenager, I fell deeply in love with a gorgeous young man named Tomas, and he fell in love with me. But my mother and father didn't approve of him. They said he was trouble. But I was always the hard-headed one, so we kept seeing one another, and eventually I became pregnant with his child. My father was enraged, and my brothers wanted to fight him. My mother said nothing. My sisters were the only ones who were happy for me. Then one day, a friend of Tomas invited us over for a party. We went to his house and we had a great time. I remember it was a beautiful night. The moon was almost full and the sky was bright with stars. As Tomas and I got ready to leave, however, another man came up to us and accused Tomas of owing him some money. The argument slowly grew out of control and in the end, Tomás was stabbed and killed. During the struggle, I was knocked to the ground on my belly. That night, I lost both Tomás and my baby. It was too much. I went into shock, and for the next week, descended into darkness, a darkness that was real and threatened to consume me. Tia Nereida's face became profoundly serious. "It was very sad," she said, "but it is past. What matters is that terrible night led me into darkness so that I could see the light, la luz. With the help of the spirits, I emerged from the darkness and began to see my power of sight as a blessing, not a curse. Now, I use that power to help others." Chapter 1. The Roots of Puerto Rican Spirituality. Puerto Rico is a small island in the Caribbean that measures only 110 miles long and 35 miles wide, making it roughly the size of the state of Connecticut. Made known to Europeans by Christopher Columbus during his voyages to the Western Hemisphere, the island was originally inhabited by the Taíno Indians. Taínos were a peace-loving people. In fact, the word Taíno means friend or relative. Their culture was shamanic, grounded in a belief in the gods of nature, and their traditions were nature-based. In addition, they believed that everyone had a personal spirit guide who served and protected them. The Taíno gladly accepted the Spanish when they came to the island, but this ultimately led to their downfall. Many died of illnesses brought by the Spanish. Others were worked to death as slaves. Although the Taíno were almost eradicated in other parts of the Caribbean, however, in Puerto Rico, many Taíno women were taken as wives by the Spanish. Thus, many of their native healing practices survived with them and were passed down to later generations. These practices later became a major influence in Puerto Rican Espiritismo. Many Spanish who came to the island came to find a better life. They were ambitious and wanted to improve their lot. In Spain, they were hampered by a class system dominated by the elite. For them, Puerto Rico was a land of opportunity, and the Taínos welcomed them with open arms into a society that was communal. No one owned anything. Everything belonged to the whole group. Only two members of each village had their own belongings: the cacique, or chief, and the shaman. The Spanish quickly began to enslave the naive and friendly Taínos. Many of them died. When they finally recognized the danger that the Spanish represented and tried to resist, it was too late, and they were cruelly oppressed. The Spanish had guns and many other weapons that the Taíno didn't have, so they were ultimately successful in their conquest of the island and its people. The Spanish killed off many of the Taíno men, but they hadn't brought their wives and children with them from Spain, so they took the Taíno women, who were reputed to be incredibly beautiful, for their own. After they had been on the island for some time, they began having children with these women and started to establish families there. The children of these families came to be known as criollos, or creoles. Although by virtue of their Spanish parentage, these children generally belonged to the middle and upper classes, they were not afforded the same rights as those who were of pure European blood. The Taíno mothers made sure to teach their children the old ways. They continued to use plants to heal and taught their children how to find their stone of power and how to live and work in the mountains. They passed the traditional songs and stories along to them. But they also adopted the Catholic saints that the Spanish had brought with them, fashioning statues of them made of wood, just as they did for their own nature gods. In time, the Spanish ways and the old Taíno ways mingled, and the songs and stories came to represent a bit of both cultures. Over time, the Taíno people became less and less sure of who they were. The old ways faded and were in danger of being lost. The gods of nature disappeared behind the Catholic saints. Their language slowly began to disappear. Although some vestiges remained, the friendly communal society of the Taíno foundered, Taino turned on Taino, and the greed of the invaders took hold. According to the history books, the Taino were completely wiped out, eradicated by the Europeans. Yet, members of my family claim this is untrue. And indeed, recent studies have shown that Puerto Ricans have more than 60% Taino DNA, with the rest made up of varying amounts of Spanish and West African heritage, more than any other part of the Caribbean. See wearemetoo.com. The Taino DNA that is carried by Puerto Ricans today comes from the maternal line, indicating that we received it from the Taino women taken as wives by the Spanish. It has also recently been discovered that the reason the Taínos were thought to have disappeared was that the Spanish dropped the classification on the census in 1800. In 1899, however, when the United States acquired the island, they did a new census that showed that more than 80% of the people in the interior of the island appeared to be of native blood, or native blood mixed with either European or African blood. So the Taino did not really disappear. They were assimilated. Because of this, many survived who treasured the ways of the old, and they kept their traditions alive as much as they could. It wasn't easy, and much was lost as each new generation moved farther and farther from their roots. But as my bisabuela, my great-grandmother, used to say, memories are weak, my son, and they don't get better with time. And yet, here we are, the Indios de Borinquen, Puerto Rico. The African influence. Starting in the early 1500s, the Spanish began using Puerto Rico as a port for the trafficking of slaves throughout the Western Hemisphere, it being a midpoint in their journey west. Yet, although many slaves were trafficked through Puerto Rico, only a small number of them stayed there at this time. Unlike many of the other islands in the Caribbean, Puerto Rico didn't really acquire a large African population until the early to mid-1800s. And even then, the African population there remained quite small in comparison to most of the other islands. In fact, it never exceeded 10%. This is vastly different from other Caribbean islands, many of whose populations were more than 40% African. Like the Taino, the various African tribes brought to Puerto Rico each had their own religious and spiritual traditions. Of all the slaves brought to the island, it's estimated that the majority, more than 80%, were of Congo Bantu origin. And the Congo, as they were called, believed in a cosmology much like that of the Taino. They believed in a creator deity and in divinities grounded in nature, as well as in personal guides who assisted individuals throughout life. But by the time a significant number of these slaves began to stay in Puerto Rico, the Spanish had already settled in and brought their culture and beliefs to bear on the older Taino ways. The Catholic Church and its program of conversion were well established. As a result, Puerto Rico retained less of the African religions than many of the other Caribbean islands. Spanish Catholics. The Spanish were strongly Catholic and very connected to the Catholic Church at the time of the conquest of Puerto Rico. In fact, from the beginning of their settling there, the Catholic Church ruled the island. Unfortunately, they made it their mission to eradicate the beliefs of the Taino, and eventually of the slaves. The control and influence of the church was particularly strong in Puerto Rico. At one time, the island had 365 Catholic churches, one for every day of the year. Thus, the process of converting the natives, and later the slaves, to Catholicism was a matter of policy and was closely monitored. Unlike on other islands of the Caribbean, the church kept a watchful eye on the conversion of both the Taino and the Africans. They were relatively successful in these conversion efforts and managed to eradicate many of the old beliefs. But the mountainous and rural nature of the island allowed many of the new Creole and old Taino people to keep personal shrines with carved statues of wooden saints known as Santos de Bulto. In many cases, these saints replaced the faces and names of the old gods, but they continued to work in just the same way that the Taíno gods had. The ancient Taíno healing practices, medicines, and techniques continued to be used, and with the help of these hybrid saints, the old magic remained powerful in their hands. In Puerto Rico, as in the rest of the Caribbean, these three cultures, the Spanish, the Taíno, and the African, came together and blended. In time, since the island was a common destination for refugees, other cultures also became mingled in. And this is the spiritual stew in which Puerto Rican Espiritismo was born. A Taína who never forgot. Whenever she visited, mi bisabuela, my great-grandmother, received many visitors. Each day was filled with familiar friends and family members, as well as others who were totally unknown to me. They came simply to pay their respects or to show her their children or grandchildren. Doña Juana was a retired spiritual healer, and many of those who came to see her had been helped by her in some way or another throughout her long career. During her visits to our house, we also often made rounds visiting various people she had known. She spoke the old tongue, the Taíno words, just like the native inhabitants of the island. Every morning, she sat in a rocking chair on the front porch, a chair that had been bought just for her visits some years back. When she left, it was kept in the basement, where no one could touch it, much less sit in it. As she rocked in her chair, with the sun pouring onto the side of her face, she sipped coffee and hummed a tune that was sweet and sad at the same time, with a hypnotizing rhythm. Over and over she hummed it, while staring into the street before her. Noticing that I was watching her from the window as I ate my hot zurullos, cornbread sticks with cheese, my grandfather said, ¿Sabes quién es? Do you know who she is? I nodded my head, yes. Go speak with her, he insisted, prodding me gently. She's only here for a few months. So off I went to see what she would say. As I came out the door, she looked at me, and a huge smile shone upon her face.
Igualito, igualito a él, Doña Juana said.
Exactly, but so exactly like him, telling me that I looked exactly like her husband, now deceased, my great-grandfather. In fact, people had reminded me more than a dozen times of this in the last few days since my great-grandmother had arrived. He was the reason I have hazel eyes, or so they tell me.
Nene, child, come here, she said, pressing me up against her, hugging me, and sitting me in her lap.
I held up some of my own weight, afraid I might be too heavy for her to lift. Relax, she said, and facing a clear, open sky and warmed by the sunshine, she began to speak. In Puerto Rico, when I awaken, I sit on the porch looking at las montañas, the mountains. There, I sing to the birds, and they come down. I call them, and birds of every color come down the mountain. They surround my little house and make miracles. How do you call them? I asked. What colors are they? They are beautiful, brilliant, bright colors, she replied. You don't have them around here. Red, yellow, and green. There are birds of one color, two colors, and many colors, but they aren't from here. I called them for you before when you were younger and at my house. Do you remember? Vaguely, at first, and then more and more clearly, I remembered being at her house in Puerto Rico and seeing it surrounded by many birds. I remembered how colorful and vibrant they were. I just had never known how or why they were there. Confirming my memory, I nodded vigorously and said, But how do you call them? With a song, of course. Just like that? I asked, attempting to snap my fingers and failing. No, it's not just any song. It is a special song that my mother taught me, a song of the Taíno. So your mom was a Taína? I asked, puzzled. Yes, she replied, looking deeply into the sky. And I am too.
We are jibaros, you know? We know the power of the earth and its beauty. Noticing a group of crows, I asked, can you call those birds here? Sure, but they are not my birds. I would rather watch them and see what they do. Let's not disturb them. Will you teach me the song? I asked. One day, but you're too young now, and it's not just a game. If you sing the song, you must know why you are doing it. Never do things just to do them. You have to have an incredibly good reason for it. Can you tell me about the Taino? I asked, moving deeper into her warmth. Of course, she replied. Long ago, our beautiful island was the home of the Indios, who were called Tainos. They were beautiful people, slender, with beautiful eyes and a warm spirit. She blinked her eyes widely. They were an innocent, pure people, simple and humble people. They had respect. All over the island, they had their chiefs, called caciques. The chiefs made sure there was peace with the people and that they had what they needed. They were healthy and strong. They were incredibly enchanting, which is why we are called the Island of Enchantment. They weren't rich in money, but in their souls, they had a great abundance. They were good people, clean people, but they were no match for the Spanish. The Spanish were not clean. They didn't bathe, I wondered. No, child. They bathed, but their hearts were dirty. Hearts don't wash with soap, my son. Ambition, greed, and jealousy are stains that don't come out just like that. That's what was wrong with the Spanish. When I was a girl, she continued, whenever you could hear drums, no one could find me. They would look and look, but they would not be able to find me anywhere. Eventually, they learned that if they could hear the drums, that's where they should look. And no matter how far away the drums were beating, I could hear them clearly. Many times, I was found miles away from my house. When I got to where the drums were, I hid in the trees watching. Often, someone saw me and invited me over. Standing at the edge of a circle, I could see people around a big bonfire. Some were dancing around it, and some were eventually possessed. The spirit Chango took them over, and they started flailing their limbs, yelling and jumping sometimes. But I was never afraid. In fact, I loved it. When the spirit overtook them, their eyes burned with fire. I loved it when Chango came on the people. He often rubbed them down and talked with them, and sometimes he danced. Then he sat near the fire, and people brought him food. Many times, he poured the food on the ground, then mixed it with dirt and ate it. Sometimes, he threw some of it in the fire. Everyone there was nice and generous with each other. I was always offered food. People were usually talking and laughing around the edges of the circle, and children were playing. It was always nice, but what I was always most drawn to was Chango and the dancing and the drums. The drums, the drums. They just called to me, my son. This was probably my first real step into the spiritual world, but I did not know at the time that one day I would also serve the spirits. It wasn't till later that I became sick and was healed by an espiritista, and that was how my own journey into the spirit world began. Chapter 2. The Birth of Espiritismo. In the mid-1800s, Spain issued a law that gave people a greater degree of personal religious freedom than ever before. Across Europe, the Catholic Church was losing some of its hold over people as well. As a result, Freemasonry societies, esoteric schools, and spiritualism gained popularity all over the continent. It was at this time that a new philosophy and esoteric spiritualistic practice known as Spiritism, Espiritismo in Spanish, emerged. Spiritism shared many of the aspects of Spiritualism. It provided a method of communicating with the spirit world. Both practices used seances to communicate with spirits from the other side. The difference between them was the purpose of those communications. Spiritists also believed in one God, the reincarnation of spirits, various planes of existence, and the ability of spirits to interact with people. They focused on the power of this communication and interaction to help humanity develop consciously and socially. Spiritism teaches that certain individuals have or can develop the powers to communicate with the spirit world. These individuals are known as mediums, or espiritistas, and they communicate with the spirits through seances, meetings at which people attempt to contact the dead or the spirits in order to get answers from the other side. These seances came to be known as sesiones in Spanish. Among its practitioners, Spiritism was considered the scientific method of spirit communication. Thus, it was not regarded as a religion at all, but rather as a new wave of science. In fact, in the early years of Espiritismo, many Spiritist sessions were led by medical doctors, lawyers, journalists, and other intellectuals. It was, in effect, the forerunner of what is now called parapsychology, the study of mental phenomena that are inexplicable by orthodox scientific means. This includes hypnosis, telepathy, psychic gifts, and other methods. Professor and researcher Allan Kardec is generally recognized as the founder of Spiritism. Although not a medium himself, Kardec compiled the findings of many other mediums. He taught that Spiritism was a philosophy that presented a new view of the world and codified it as a method of research into the evolution of man. Although Spiritism was not a religion, he claimed, it could give people a deeper understanding of spiritual things. Thus, at first, it wasn't considered a major threat by the Catholic Church. Kardec's form of Spiritism was also known as scientific Spiritism. In the mid-1800s, many wealthy families in Puerto Rico started sending their children to universities back in Europe. The island simply couldn't provide access to the educational resources that were available there. In Europe, these children were exposed to the teachings of Kardec and brought them back to Puerto Rico. Kardec's Spiritism proved to be a perfect fit for many of the upper and middle class Creole elites who had grown tired of the Catholic Church's political power. Although many were Catholic themselves, they sought freedom and socio-political progress that was not forthcoming from the Church. They wanted radical changes in the way society functioned and felt that Kardec's scientific Spiritism could support that vision. The Espiritistas who followed Kardec's teachings created many public hospitals, schools, communities.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.